Today, I learned that giving a specific name to a color is actually way more important than I thought it was. And by that, I mean the name of a color is not just a label that we assign to a specific hue to facilitate communication. It actually changes the way we perceive and relate to these colors. And also, yes, it also is a way to facilitate communication. But what does this actually mean in real life? Well, it means that giving specific names to specific hues makes us sharper at spotting these colors among others, and actually perceiving them as different hues. We gave this specific hue the name green, so our brains easily know that this is green, and not this. This is orange, which we can also easily spot because we know this is orange. We even gave it a name, orange. Okay, so by this we're implying that people who speak different languages perceive colors differently, like red is not the same color as rojo and vermelho. Well, a good portion of modern civilizations and languages assign names to the same specific hues. So no, red, rojo and vermelho are all the same thing. We're all seeing the same red. But at the same time, also yes. Different languages can make you perceive colors differently, even if just slightly. While we have 11 basic colors in English, some other languages might have fewer words, like the Candoshi language spoken by South American natives in Peru. They have 8 words for basic colors, but one of them is used to refer to desaturated colors, which is really different than the way we're used to speak. And in fact, the Candoshi words for colors are still developing. Until recently, a single category was used to refer to both greens and blues. But now, the category seems to be splitting, making space for a new word. The original term is retracting from greens, which now has its own unique name. Okay, but this is very confusing. Let me give you some examples. Stick with me. Look at these 3 colors. This is red, this is orange, and this is brown, right? Piece of cake. But what if we add this color? You would probably say, well, this is just dark red. It's not actually a different color, but rather a shade of the color red. I mean, it clearly is a different color. You can see where one ends and the other begins. But for all purposes, this is still red. Just darker. Then, why don't we call brown dark orange? Because, like, that's what it is. Brown is just a darker shade of orange. Brown is orange, just darker. Then, why? Well, we have absolutely no use giving dark red a unique name. Where do you even see dark red? Blood? Your Christmas sweater? Grapes if you're trying really hard? Yeah, it's not like it's everywhere. When you see it, you can just call it red, but darker. Now, brown is a whole new deal, because brown is everywhere. Brown is the color of wood. It is the color of dirt. Brown is the color of cooked meat, leather, animal fur, nuts, even some fruits. So we have every reason to give brown its own unique name. We won't just call it dark orange. It's more special than that. So when you see this color, you call it brown and not dark orange. You perceive it as being its own unique color and not a shade of orange, because it has its own unique name. Brown is brown and not dark orange, even though it also is dark orange. And just like naming a color enhances our perception of it being its own unique color, the opposite is also true. The color blue clearly has 2 very distinct hues in the spectrum, yet we still perceive them only as blue and dark blue, even though they have their own shades of dark and light. They're just not important enough to have distinct names. Like, apart from the sky, where do you even see blue in nature? Not even blue cars are that common. So we look at this and it's blue, and we look at this and it's also blue. Even though they are clearly different hues. Sure, some people call this cyan, just like they refer to pink as magenta. But if shown this color, no one would disagree that it is blue. Another way we can look at how these words affect our perception is by observing the color spectrum. If we divide the color spectrum in the respective ranges that each color name covers, we can see something very peculiar. Notice how the word green covers the biggest range in the spectrum, while over here, color names refer to very specific hues. Well, it's very useful for humans to differentiate green from other colors. It helps, for example, to discern unripe from ripe fruits. But there is little reason for us to discern between the different hues of green. Sure, grass has a different green than the leaves of a plant, but being good at discerning this isn't very helpful to us. So it is all just called green. Now, have you seen how many colors ripe fruits and vegetables can be? It's a full rainbow. Maybe if ripe fruits and vegetables were all different hues of green, we would have lots and lots of words. But since they're not, this huge chunk of colors is just green. I used food here as an example, but many other things probably contributed to specific hues having their own unique names, like red being the color of blood and fire, and blue being the color of the sky. And there's also biology and the way our eyes work. But the point is, the way we perceive the world around us is so much more complex than we imagine. And I think there is a frightening beauty in just how complex it is. Anyway, this is what I've learned today. And now, so did you. Bye!